We also have a lot of fun with each other, and we genuinely really like each other. I mean, most of the time.
Too much fun.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to Entertainment Weekly's Three Rounds. I am so excited to introduce our guests from Top Chef Season 18, members of the All-Star Judging Panel, Brooke Williamson, Kwame Onwuachi, Melissa King, and Tiffany Derry.
Hey, hey, hey.
Let's get going with round one.
Hey, how we doing? Big shout out to my fellow judges out there. So listen, I have a cocktail that I want to start with. This is called the Spaghetti Western. It's a takeoff on a Negroni. This one starts with tequila. So it's equal amounts of tequila, mezcal, bitters, any kind of bitters. Mezcal will do, Luxardo bitters, Cointreau, and then a little bit of, I hit mine with a little bit of bitters as well, just to make it extra bitter because I like bitter. And you kind of give it a good shake over ice and garnish it with an orange. And that's it. It is delicious. Cheers.
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 Great seeing all of you.
It's fantastic.
It's exactly what I would have made at home for myself.
This is what I would order anywhere if I saw it on a menu.
What have you guys been up to since your season or seasons? And if we could get a reminder of where we saw you first.
Since you saw me first, that was like 9 years ago, on season 10 of Top Chef in Seattle. I came in second, so therefore I thought I'd torture myself and come back for another round in season 14 in Charleston, and I'm glad I did. You know, if you're a Bravo watcher, that is where you saw me last. But I've been up to a lot of stuff. This last year has been an interesting one. A year ago, I had four restaurants. I'm now down to one, but very focused on it in Playa del Rey. It's called Playa Provisions. Did another competition show called Tournament of Champions, because apparently we can't get enough of that competitive torture that we put on ourselves.
She's just winning everything.
But you know, like once you figure out you're good at something, you want to like keep doing what you're good at, right? I had a lot of fun with these guys right here, judging the most recent season of Top Chef. It was an interesting experience. I'm sure we'll get into that, but that's kind of what I've been up to.
Since I was on Top Chef, that was like 6 years ago. I've opened five restaurants. I've written three books. I have a movie coming out based off of one of those books. I started a media company, you know, creating my own shows that I would like to see with representation of you know, so much diversity and different types of people and walks of life. And now I'm developing shows for other talent as well. So, you know, it's been a really crazy ride since I was on Top Chef last. You know, I was living in Queens as a line cook, and then I moved to DC to open up some restaurants, moved back to New York to open a restaurant, and then the pandemic hit, so I couldn't even finish that project. So I made the trip over to LA. And, you know, recently I became the executive producer for Food & Wine magazine. So I am heading up, you know, events, and I have this event called the Family Reunion, where it's celebrating Black and Brown voices in the food industry at Salamander Resort and Spa, and then Aspen as well, which I'm helping with the programming, which is it's a great place. So it's cool to see the trajectory. I never knew how I would get here, but the journey is the reward, and I'm happy to be here.
Let's see here. I started on the show. What was that, 7 years ago with Top Chef season 12 on Boston. Placed as a finalist there. I was really proud of myself and just all the growth and development that I went through as a chef and as a person through the Top Chef experience. And then just like Brooke, decided to go and compete again because I just like a good challenge here and there. So went back on All Stars season 17, did well there, got fan favorite. Won the show. Since then, it's been nuts. I just feel so grateful for the opportunity. And I guess since COVID, I mean, the show aired during COVID. So there's been a lot of changes in the sense of pivoting my work to more virtual, basically pivoting my work to the virtual space with virtual cooking classes. I have a lot of charities that I kind of tie in tandem with them, and I'm very proud to support communities out there that I just feel so proud of, and working on a few book deals at the moment. Just keeping busy. Yeah, I like to keep myself busy with projects.
Oh my gosh. I can't believe that I did season 7 DC 10 years ago. Like, oh my gosh, I was a whole new person then. So season 7, one fan favorite. Totally didn't expect that at all. Like, I mean, you know, I'm like, who, what? What's going on? Was asked to go back for season 8, which was less than 3 months after finishing season 7. That was insane, to the point where I was like, wait, what am I doing? I think I'm going to just say yes. 7 was very dramatic in my end, because my refrigerator froze. So there were a lot of people who were very upset. I think even more upset than I was. And so coming back season 8 was very, very different. And I didn't really have the chance to get acclimated to like going on Top Chef. I was filming season 8 when my episodes were airing. So it was a very different, you know, most people, you know, have, you know, lived and a few years later you get back on and, you know, but I didn't quite know how life would change, nor did I really know anyone who had competed. So it was very, very different. I started doing Bar Rescue soon after. I do that craziness. I like it. And Top Chef Junior as well, judging. And right now I have 2 restaurants. One concept, Roots Chicken Shack in Plano, and another in Austin. And we have a new restaurant opening next month called Roots Southern Table. So we're getting ready to do that. And that's exciting.
Well, I think it's a good time to toss it to Gail Simmons, of course. And let's see what she wants us to drink next.
Hey, kids, I miss you. Like, really, really miss you. So happy you guys are drinking together tonight. Wish I could join you, but instead I'm giving you the Gale cocktail, which is the closest thing you can get to being with me. It was actually created by my friend Leo Robichek, who's an incredibly gifted bar chef in New York City. And it's because I had a fascination with cucamelons. And he originally made the recipe to be with cucamelons. And I know y'all like cucamelons too. If you can't find cucamelons, obviously you can make it with cucumber, and it is delicious. Enjoy. Cheers.
Cheers. Cheers.
Cheers, Gail.
I wanted to know, we see you guys as all-stars in Quick Fires, in, of course, the final judging panel. How did they kind of figure that out? Because you said you had a lot of downtime. Was it like, hey, Brooke, we're going to need you today, and surprise, this is a quick fire.
No, I mean, I think it was different for everyone. Like, myself, I was only there for 4 episodes, but I believe that any of us who were out of quarantine were in the episodes, whether it be at Judge's Table or in a quick fire or as a diner for the Elimination Challenge. I believe if we were there, we were there, right?
What was your favorite part of coming back and getting a chance to taste the food of people where, like, you know what it's like to be in their shoes?
You know, just, it's an honor, I think, to be back. And you know, we all know what it feels like. Like, we all know every moment. And when, you know, you're sitting at the table and they're looking at you and you see in their eyes, right? And you're like, I know this feeling. Like, you know, I know what's going on. Before any judge tells you that you've messed up, you already know where you messed up at. And if you are an active yeah, thinker, usually, you're thinking about every step. Yeah, if you're an active thinker, you're thinking about every
Some
step,
people
you know.
Don't know.
But then I question it. I'm like, did you really not know? Or are you gonna sit here and act like you didn't know? But okay. But you know, I think, you know, a lot of people do know before we taste anything where, you know, where they've messed up or where what they wish they would have done a little bit different or what they were aiming for, whether they ran out of time, whether they forgot to add something on the plate that they had spent time cooking, right? There are just so many different steps. So to be on the other side looking, like everyone has said, empathy is one of the things that we definitely understand. And also, you know, just sort of seeing the progression is great. And being on the other side of the table is great.
Yeah, I think to echo that sentiment, like, to me, it's really important to come off as relatable to the chefs instead of judgmental. And I think that's we've all been privy to people judging us for one reason or another. And I think that we all understand that that doesn't that doesn't help anyone, right? And I think that coming from a place that we all come from, we want nothing more than to see these people succeed. We gain no joy from seeing people screw up or berating people or embarrassing people. We are an incredibly supportive group of people and come from a place of support and genuine like interest and excitement in seeing these people succeed. So I think that our perspective is a very specific and very unique one.
In honor of Champagne Padma, who we were introduced to last season, we're going to pop a little bit of bubbly. So let's get
there
this
go.
Going.
Yeah. Ooh.
Champagne guys. Padma. Whoa. Woo.
Hey, everybody. You know how much fun I like to have with bubbles. So I like the cocktail with champagne.
Cheers, guys.
Cheers.
Cheers.
It's third round. Let's get a little spicy.
Ooh, I like spice.
I would think one of the fun parts of being on the official judging panel is getting a chance to really push back against the permanent judges, of course, Tom, Padma, and Gail. Did you guys ever find yourselves taking advantage of this situation where you could be like, well, actually, I thought that this chef testin did an amazing job, or you're wrong, it doesn't need that much salt. Et cetera, et cetera.
I know for sure I did pretty much every single episode. I gave my opinion 100,000%. If you didn't like me, I don't care. I was here. I'm at the table. Now I got something to say.
To me, it's less about taking advantage of the situation and more about trusting in your own opinions and believing that what you have to say is valuable information.
Chefs have personalities, but we'd certainly, I think all of us were seen on very equal planes in the eyes of Padma, Tom, and Gail. So there was never this, you know, we are below them and we have to like prove anything. I mean, they very much valued our input and our opinions across the board, whether or not we agreed with them.
Is there anything you're proud the show did this season to really highlight and help the restaurant industry?
You know, I think you're supposed to do work when the camera's on and when the camera's off. And I think that's where the real work happens. So, you know, Tom and I and a couple other people started the Independent Restaurant Coalition, where we were able to get upwards of $40 billion in the last stimulus plan carved out just for restaurants. And it was a long road. I mean, it happened before I was even asked to go back on the show. You know, we had a little bit of downtime because the pandemic hit, our restaurants closed, and it started by just sharing information. We would get on these Zoom calls every morning, mad early, and, you know, talk about what was happening in each other's cities because we were just looking at the news for answers. So we had to call our peers to ask, like, what are you doing with your staff? How do you even apply for a PPP loan? Do I have to pay this thing back? You know, and with that, you know, I think that's where the real work happens, where it's not televised.
I personally feel like what Top Chef does so beautifully is give us all a platform, give us a voice that we can get out to so many more people than we could if we didn't have Top Chef. And I think that just, and even for the chefs competing, you know, on a smaller sort of more specific level, these chefs who have been, most of them working their butts off during quarantine, like all of us, just to sort of survive. Top Chef is giving them a platform to where their restaurants or whatever they do is being recognized, not only, you know, immediately in their own communities, but nationally. And I think that it's unlike anything that you can get from any PR company, you know, just the recognition that you are able to get. And what you do with that is completely up to you, right? They give you this platform, but what you're able to make of that and who you decide to advocate for comes from yourself.
Top Chef also just does an incredible job with just the casting alone. Like, this season is the most diverse season that I've seen, and they're really set on amplifying these voices. And I think that trickles through with the people watching the show and finding inspiration through their stories. And even people like us, our group, our alumni panel is extremely diverse. And I think that alone shows so much representation and support through the media, which echoes throughout, on so many levels.
What's your relationship to Top Chef as a viewer?
Top Chef still stresses me out. It stresses me out. I'm not gonna lie. I'm sitting there, I'm on the edge, and most of the time I'm live tweeting or doing something, you know, if I'm home to watch it. And I'm just stressed, you know, and I'm thinking to myself, don't do that, don't change, you know, like all of these things you can see sometimes it going down for someone, or, you know, that countdown and you're like, uh-oh, you're missing something, uh-oh, you know, and so it's, yeah, it stresses me out.
I'm watching it as a viewer and I'm actually enjoying really getting attached to certain people, although all of us here know the outcome of what happens and who wins. So in that sense, it's not as exciting the way it is for, you know, someone that's not part of the Top Chef world to be watching it as a sports competition.
I can't tell you how many people have come to me over the last year and said, or like before there was even sports airing, which there is right now, that they watched Top Chef or they watched competitive cooking TV. And that really got them through the lack of sports and gave them what they felt like they were missing.
I think when the contestants are at judges' table, there's a bit of stoicism and like mental dexterity that it takes to like even get through judges' table. And that's where we see them. So like I'm rooting for them in different ways than I was when I was even on the show. Because I'd be like, oh, that's why they forgot that sauce. That's why they were so in their head on this Mother's Day challenge, you know, like learning the reasons why behind they're making these mistakes that they have to just sit up there and take it at judge's table and not really explain themselves, or they seem like they're combative or making excuses. But it's a process.
Once again, I want to thank my guests, Brooke Williamson, Kwame Onwuachi, Melissa King, and Tiffany Derry.
Cheers.
Thank you guys.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Cheers.